enormous quantities of money are thrown around in the news, and I have no idea what they mean. For example, did you know that in the UK we spend over £100 billion a year on the NHS? We spend £15 billion on our mobile phones. We even spend £80 million a year on peanuts. But I've got no idea how these numbers fit into the bigger picture. And so I decided to try and bring them down onto a scale that I could understand. And when you do that, the most surprising numbers are those that relate to science. So I want to give you a bit of a tour of the UK sort of national accounts and where scientific research fits into all of that. So a good place to start is with one of those mind-bogglingly enormous numbers. The government spends somewhere in the region of £700 billion every single year on all of our behalves. Now, again, that number just doesn't make any sense to me, so I decided to try and make sense of it by dividing it by the population of the UK. And if you take that number and divide it by the 63 million or so of us who live in the United Kingdom, you get a number that suddenly makes a lot more sense. It's about £11,000 per person per year is spent by the government. And that number is more on the same scale as my salary, or maybe it's about a year's rent, so it's a number that I can sort of begin to access. But where does that £11,000 go? Well, most of the big ticket items are fairly obvious and laudable ways to spend our money. We spend about £4,000 a year on what's called social protection, that's benefits and pensions and that kind of thing. We spend almost £2,000 on healthcare, we spend quite a lot on education, quite a lot on defence, and obviously those are just the really high profile categories. There's also this sort of catch-all other £3,500 for everything from parks to policing that the government also funds. But where does science fit into all of this? Well, it's actually funded by a slightly confusing number of different routes from all across government. And in total, the amount that the UK government spends on research and development is about £160 per person per year. Now, at the moment, I don't really know if that's a lot or a little, because on the one hand, it's less than 1.5% of government spending, it's a really tiny figure. But on the other hand, if I got a £160 tax rebate every year, I could probably buy a cool gadget or something, so maybe it's not such a small amount of money. The real way to try and make sense of this is to look at the individual problems that science is trying to solve. And one place we could start, perhaps, is by looking at health. So imagine that these are 10 average people in the United Kingdom. A slightly morbid way to get a handle on health is to look at what kills us. So cancer kills about a third of us, and yet we spend just £4.30 per person per year on public-funded cancer research. Now, if there's a disease that's got a 30% chance of killing me, I'd like to spend more than a fiver a year trying to work out why, and maybe how to stop it doing that. But what's worse is that cancer is by far the best funded condition. Heart disease kills 15% of us, about half as many as cancer. We spend just £1.30 per person per year on public funded heart disease research, and stroke kills 10% of people. We spend 28 pence a year researching it. Now, not to be patronising, but this is a picture of 28 pence. This, if you live in the UK, is your entire annual contribution to researching stroke. Now, frankly, that would be slightly rude to leave as a tip in a restaurant, let alone a contribution to a disease that kills 10% of people, possibly including the waiter you just insulted. Now, obviously, science medical research isn't all about preventing death. What's really important as well is quality of life, and that's much harder to quantify. But one way to try and get a handle on that is to perhaps look at the economic cost of diseases. And a really interesting disease from that point of view is dementia, because dementia is something that affects a lot of older people, but it doesn't very often kill you. A lot more people die with dementia than of dementia. And because you therefore have to be looked after for a number of years, it's a very expensive disease. In fact, the direct health and social care costs of dementia are about £160 per person per year in the UK. And that's stuff like looking after people on the NHS, giving them drugs and that sort of thing. Then there are the indirect costs of the disease, which are much larger than these direct costs. That's things like people giving up work to look after elderly relatives and that kind of stuff. When you add up all these indirect effects that dementia has on the economy, that's another £200 per person per year. So you can combine those. The combined effect of dementia on the economy is £360 per person per year. I'd like to emphasise this is literally everyone, every single one of us in this room, everyone in the whole UK, not just dementia sufferers. And we can contrast that with how much we spend on dementia research. It's that little green line there. It's 60 pence per person per year is spent researching Alzheimer's and related conditions. We can do a similar kind of analysis for the other three diseases that I mentioned, cancer, stroke and heart disease, and that whole massive rectangle comes to about £800 a year. We spend £7 per person per year researching all of these diseases combined, so that's less than 1% of the amount they cost the economy. So even if there weren't a huge human imperative to try and spend more on disease research, there's a massive economic one as well. And this is a problem that recurs across science. The amount that we spend on scientific research is dwarfed by the size of the problems that science is trying to solve. So, as well as health, another thing that's very expensive is energy. We spend about £2,200 per person per year on energy in the UK. That's literally everything: petrol, heating, lighting, factories, shops, the works. And if you add all those things up and divide them by 63 million, you get about £2,200 each. So obviously that's a pretty big chunk of your salary, for example. But also there's an environmental imperative to do something about energy, because most of the ways that we generate it are very bad for the environment. We release carbon dioxide, which is causing dangerous climate change, and other kinds of pollution, which are again bad for our health or bad for the environment. So there's another strong reason why we should be investing in energy research. So against this huge economic and environmental challenge, we're spending somewhere in the region of £10 per person per year on energy research. Now, as a recovering ex-physicist, I've got a soft spot for one particular technology, and that's called nuclear fusion. Nuclear fusion is a potentially transformative power source. It's the source of energy that powers the sun. It's kept it burning for 5 billion years. It's going to keep it burning for the next 5 billion. And the way that it works is that you smash hydrogen atoms together, and when they come together at high enough speed, they fuse into helium, and in the process release a huge quantity of energy. What's even better is, as well as powering the sun, there's plenty of fuel down here on the surface of the Earth as well. We think there's about 10 million years worth of fusion fuel on the Earth's surface, if you consider using energy at the rate our civilization currently does. Even better than that, it doesn't release any carbon dioxide, and even though it's got nuclear in the name, there's no long-lived radioactive waste. So this really would completely transform the way humanity generated its power. The problem is, if you know anything about the sun, you probably know it's very hot. And that is the chief challenge with fusion. To get those hydrogen nuclei to stick together, you have to raise them up to hundreds of millions of degrees. And that's a massive engineering challenge. It's an engineering challenge that we've been working on for quite some time now. And in fact, that's the biggest problem with fusion. When you mention it to people, they normally say one of three things. Hasn't that been 30 years away for the last 30 years? Hasn't that been 50 years away for the last 50 years? Or hasn't that been 30 years away for the last 50 years? Now, cynics. If the world could be powered by the jaded aphorisms of cynical smartasses, we'd all be laughing, metaphorically at least. But I think this betrays a fundamental misunderstanding of the way that science works. No amount of time spent not looking for a cure for cancer is going to find one, and similarly, if we continue to underinvest in fusion research, it's going to take us a long time to crack it. I think it makes more sense to think of fusion not as being a certain number of years away, but as being a certain investment, a certain number of nerd hours away from fruition. So, luckily, we have got a plan. The scientists who are working on fusion think it's going to cost us about 60 billion quid to go from where we are now, the experimental reactors, to actually putting watts on power grids of electricity. Now, that sounds like a lot of money, but actually, when you think about it, there might be quite a lot of people interested in near-infinite clean energy. Say, at least the population of the developed world, so we can divide that £60 billion by the 1.1 billion people who live in what are called the high-income countries. That's basically the rich part of the world, the people who could afford to pay for this stuff. And when you do that sum, it comes out as £50 per person. Now, I'd put my 50 quid on the table right now for this utterly transformative power source. And in fact, we wouldn't even need to do that, because it's going to take time to build the labs, do the experiments, train the scientists. And so we could scrape together this 50 quid over a number of years. And suddenly, when looked at through this lens, I think that fusion seems an awful lot closer. So that's health and energy, and it's very easy to make a compelling case for spending more on health and energy research, because there's a very definite, obvious social impact of the research that you're doing. The consequences are very clear and very positive. But what about basic science, blue skies research? Research that's just pure curiosity. We don't know where it's going to lead. Well, an example that people often give when you talk about this kind of science with no particular aim in mind is space exploration. And you might have noticed that recently humanity touched down on the surface of a comet. Now, this is a hugely important space mission. From a sort of basic science point of view, this comet lander is going to teach us about the origins of the solar system and maybe the origins of life. From a sort of technological spin-offs point of view, doing these audacious feats of space engineering mean that regular engineering tends to inherit new bits of technology that developed from it. And finally, there's the vitally important inspirational value. This thing was just cool. And if we want to inspire future generations of scientists and engineers, we need these kind of big, high-profile projects that are going to be on the news all over the world in order to make that happen. But nonetheless, you might still be scratching your head. Those benefits are all quite hand-waving. How much does it cost to land on a comet? Well, it's quite easy. If you go on the internet, you can find out the number. It's about 1.4 billion euros to create this Rosetta mission, send it into space, and touch it down on the surface of comet 67P Churyumov-Gerasimenko. Now, that again sounds like an incredibly large amount of money, but it's really important to put these figures in context. So let's try and give it an engineering context first. What can you buy with 1.4 billion euros? Well, it's about the same as the price of 4.2 Airbus A380 aircraft. And the A380 is a pretty cool bit of engineering, but it's not going to get you into space. And I think another thing that's important to mention is these are production airliners. This is something that's being manufactured continuously, whereas the Rosetta probe was a bespoke robotic spacecraft. So, you know, the first Airbus A380 would have cost much more than a few hundred million dollars. And so you can see that actually the Rosetta probe in this context doesn't seem like such bad value. And to bring it down onto my favourite scale per person, you can then divide the amount that we spent on Rosetta by the number of people who paid for it. And actually it comes out as about €3.50 per European. That's because it was launched by ESA, the European Space Agency, which is a massive collaboration of countries, most of Europe's involved. And so if you divide that 1.4 billion by the number of people who paid for it, it comes out as around €3.50. So that was to land a spacecraft on the surface of a comet. You can compare that to the €8.50 it would have cost you to go and see a load of actors flying a computer-generated spaceship into a computer-generated wormhole had you gone to see Interstellar. And that's based on the average UK cinema ticket price. If you go to one of the swankiest cinemas in London, I think you could probably pay €20, and that's before you bought any snacks. This is absolutely incredible that we can send a spaceship to the surface of another world in our solar system for a price that's comparable to that of a cinema ticket. And I think looked at on this scale, again, Rosetta seems incredible value. And actually, you can make it seem even better value than that, because this project took place over about 20 years, the design, the build, the launch, waiting for it to travel through the solar system, obtaining and analysing the results. And if you do that division, it turns out the Rosetta mission cost us in Europe somewhere in the region of 20 euro cents per person per year, which is incredibly cheap for this thing that's advancing the bounds of human exploration and human knowledge. So that's a lot of numbers that I've tried to bring down onto an intelligible scale, make them small and try and make them understandable. Let's look at some really big picture stuff, some parts of the global economy, and see where huge scientific projects fit into that. One thing that's often cited as a very expensive scientific endeavour is the LHC, the Large Hadron Collider. That's this massive 27-kilometre long tunnel under Geneva where we discovered the Higgs boson. And for this £2.6 billion, you know, it sounds quite expensive, we got 27 kilometres of tunnel in which we can accelerate proton subatomic particles to 99.999999% the speed of light. Let's try and think of something to compare that to. Say, Crossrail. That's a new train project being built across London. For that, we're going to get going to cost £15 billion, and for that we get 21 kilometres of tunnel in which we accelerate trains to 0.00001% the speed of light. So if you compare fairly mediocre bits of public infrastructure to science, suddenly the science looks incredibly cheap. I also mentioned fusion. It's going to cost us about £60 billion, we think, to get from where we are now to actually putting electricity on grids. Let's compare that to the amount of revenue that Apple made on the iPhone between 2007 and 2012, so this figure isn't even up to date. £123 billion was made by Apple. And bad news, iPhone owners, over half of that was profit. So what that means is that Apple could single-handedly have developed nuclear fusion using the profits from just a single product line. Instead, they developed a big iPhone, a smaller big iPhone, and most recently, a big small iPhone with a fingerprint reader. Actually, come to think of it, it's probably a good thing they didn't invest their R&D budget in fusion and create the iTokamak fusion reactor, because if they had, you could only get the electricity out if you had a special custom-made expensive cable. And even then, only if you had an iTunes account. Nonetheless, you can see that the amounts of money that are being thrown around in commerce dwarf the amounts of money we need to make transformative scientific advances. And here's another scary number. This is the total amount of money we spent on health research all around the world between 1981 and 2010. So it's about 30 years of global public-funded health research, about £600 billion. We can compare that to the cost of the war in Iraq just to the United States of America, which was £1.8 trillion. Now, whatever your political views on the motivations behind that war and so on, I think it's pretty clear that 90 years of health research, which is effectively what I could have funded, would have been more beneficial to humankind than that particular war. So that's some huge numbers to boggle the mind. What is 1.8 billion, trillion even, pounds? Let's go back to those everyday figures that I've been trying to ground us all in for the rest of the talk. These are some of the figures I've mentioned so far, the energy, cancer, stroke, heart disease spends, all in pounds per person per year. And since we've talked quite a bit about health, let's compare that to the amount that we spend here in the UK on alcohol. It's actually about £600 per person per year, and that's literally every man, woman and child, so you've got to hope some of them aren't drinking. Now, I don't want a world where there's no alcohol, but there's another five times as much science. That'd be a pretty dull place to live. But equally, if I was a space alien, and I touched down on the surface of planet Earth, and I was trying to work out what it was about this strange species I'd found myself amongst, I might log on to the Office of National Statistics website. Now, the first thing I'd think is, my God, this species has got a lot to learn about web design. But if I did eventually find the document I was looking for, I would see that these guys spend £600 a year each on booze and £5 a year on a disease that kills a third of them. These kind of numbers just don't make any sense. Something else that doesn't make any sense, weddings. We spend £160 per person per year in the UK getting married, which, if you're being observant, is about the entire amount that we spend on scientific research. And finally, loo roll. We spend £17 per person per year on toilet paper in the UK. Now, again, I don't want a world where there's no toilet paper but a little bit more science. I value having a clean bum. But equally, I'm sure I'm not 100% efficient with my toilet paper. I think I could probably cut back by 10% if I really tried. And that would give me £1.70 a year to play with. I could use that to double what we spend on heart disease research. I could use it to septuple the amount we spend researching stroke. And these numbers are just ridiculous. And I think once this slide starts to look a little bit less ridiculous, we're finally getting somewhere with science funding. So that was the Scienceogram. I hope I've managed to put all those ridiculous figures into context, boil them down to pounds per person per year, and for you made sense of science spending. If you want to see some more statistics and stuff like this, then visit the website on scienceogram.org or follow us on Twitter. Thank you.